given us several, several thoughts, and he is the key person in giving some shape to the raw thoughts which are being illustrated in this paper proposal. So over to you, sir, please enlighten us. Thank you.
Expert panelists in the evening, Professor Nitish Purohit and his colleagues, good evening to all of you. This particular panel was very mind-blowing, to be very precise, and was able to get into the real problems. Professor U.B. Desai's concern, Director Khadakpur's concerns, and Professor from IIT Chennai's concerns are very, very valid. In fact, the moment we just open up the Pandora's box that there is flexibility, surely second tier IIT students would love to take the courses only in the first tier IIT. That has got to be understood. And then NITs, all students at NITs, all students at IITs would love to find a slot to take the courses in IITs, because a certification for them that they have done a course at IIT could probably, they think, would be very valid for their lifetime. And that's exactly what is going to happen. In other words, the movement of a candidate would be from a lower potential institution into a higher potential institution, and surely it causes an imbalance. When I just went into Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore, in those days there was a very interesting opening remark. Whoever is entering Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore, is surely the topper of your respective places. Every topper of the respective place has entered into Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. But after having entered, it is very difficult for everybody to retain the top position at Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore, which was very credibly expressed by U.B. Desai, that somebody even trying to get a 6.5 grade, although he might have been getting 9.5 or 9.8 in his institution, would become very difficult, which is really a challenging problem to be addressed. But however, let us resolve the problem, let us get into the problem step by step. Question number one is the introduction and practicing of flexibility as advocated by national education policy. I'm very positive that the national education policy picked up the flexibility that IITs have been practicing, that even the Birla Institutes are practicing, and that the Indian Institute of Science is practicing. For most of us, NEP need not be the trendsetter as far as flexibility is concerned, because most of us have already been into the business of flexibility. Now the question is, can this flexibility go to a little higher level? As director of IIT Khadakpur mentioned, the NEP was also a cause for us to trigger providing more flexibility within our own system, and that is where the flexibility has been gaining a better momentum. Well, then that basically reduces the problem to the following, that the institution should not be conservative to tell that if a candidate has got to become a graduate, electronics graduate, he has got to study 80% to 90% only electronic subject. That's the conservative approach has got to come down. Surely the one which happens with the Western world, the Western universities, perhaps should be followed. Like, majority has got to be in electronics, the majoring has got to be in electronics, and the remaining subjects have got to be as flexible as possible, including taking up the credits in swimming, including taking up the credits in music, or whatever the candidate would feel like. Therefore, this is the type of flexibility. So flexibility at the institutional level has got to be thought of. Then from the institution, it has got to rise to the level of not intra-institutional flexibility, inter-institutional flexibility, which already has been practiced by most of the IITs. Well, then it is practiced in some of the IITs also. We do allow our candidate to go for one semester at most outside and come back. Okay, that's what. So in 100, out of 160 credits, one has got to clearly define how many credits could be flexibly picked up from other institutions. So that has got to be clearly defined. It is not that out of 160 credits of BTech program, the flexibly one would pick up 100 credits from outside and still claim to have a degree from IIIT Allahabad, which is also incorrect. So a person entering into some, as Professor UB Desai very categorically mentioned, would enter into one of the typical young IIITs and would do only 30 to 40 credits in that institute, and the remaining 120 credits he would pick up from all remaining institutions and would still claim to have a degree from the institution where he has joined is not understandable at all, and that practice should be curbed. It is not a right practice at all. Therefore, there has got to be a limit defined, very, very, very practically defined, that how many credits one could pick up. Now, if one goes outside for, getting a credit advantage, then that entire semester, we have got to be clear that he will not be available in the host institution. Therefore, the guest institution should be ready to accommodate this candidate for the maximum number of credits that could be earned in that particular semester, which means minimum, let us say 12 credits, maximum up to 20 credits, the candidate should be able to register in the institution other than this institution, and he has got to be away for that particular one semester. Then the remaining logistics have got to be thought of. The remaining administrative logistics have got to be clearly thought of. None of us are looking into the administrative aspects, because the institution, the host institution, will collect the tuition fees and we send them for a credit transfer to the other institution. Then we should make the transfer, the proportionate transfer of the tuition fees to that guest institution also. So the flexibility at the first level should be within the institution, then the inter-institutional flexibility. But this type of flexibility, the flexible academic program, which Professor Nitish Purohit is trying to promote, has got to be thought entirely differently. It should not be thought of admitting a candidate at IIT Kharagpur and allowing him to enjoy the maximum flexible academic system. It should not be thought of that a candidate would join IIT Kanpur or a candidate would join IIIT Allahabad. Therefore, there has got to be entirely a different mechanism which has got to be thought of. So we have got to think of the existence of some virtual institution, which now Nitish Purohit, to begin with, he had called it as consortium of institutions. So the admission will be into the consortium, or admission of a candidate will be into a virtual institution. Why should we call this as a virtual institution? This is called a virtual institution because this institution shall not offer any academic programs by itself. It shall not design any academic programs by itself. It shall not recruit teachers. It shall not recruit teachers by itself, but it shall depend upon all the faculty members of the participating institutions for its academic program. Therefore, the virtual institution, call it whatever may be, like Honorable Vice Chancellor of Gujarat Technological University mentioned that getting the tag of a virtual institution at parliament level could be difficult. You call it as consortium, you call it as a lead institution, you call it as the organizing institution, or you call it as a remote institution which would do this activity. But then this virtual institution does not create its own academic or research infrastructure. To that extent, it is virtual. It has got to make use of the resources available, in which case The participating institution should clearly tell so much of academic infrastructure we can share with this virtual institution. So that's the quantum of academic infrastructure. It could be research infrastructure, it could be teaching infrastructure, it could be even hostel infrastructure when the students would be there in that particular semester. All these things have got to be clearly be defined and should be shared. This is the first level. What is this virtual institution going to do? Virtual institution is going to do the real coordination activity. Though it is a virtual institution, the reality of this virtual institution is in coordinating. The real coordination, the academic administration part has got to be taken over by this virtual institution, which naturally implies transportation of learners. It has got to move the learners from one institution to the other institution. That it has got to do, and then assign the learners with the specific institutes and the courses. The assignment problem has got to be solved. This is a very difficult non-deterministic polynomial problem, very hard non-deterministic problem, because the students are enrolled into the virtual institution. Surely they are not the students of any NIT, they are not the students of any IIIT, they are not the students of any IIT, but they come from that system. I shall come a little later to the greater details of how this could be made operational. But anyhow, the transporting the students through these institutes and assigning them, solving the assignment problem of allocating the courses to them, and still maintaining to see that they have completed required number of credits in order to get a electronics degree, in order to get a computer science degree, in order to get an information technology degree. These are the things which have got to be coordinated by this virtual institution. Having said that, the most important point is why anybody would join IIT Kharagpur or why anybody would join IIT Chennai. Well, one point is naturally, which is only on the book, Professor U.B. Desai should also accept this point. This point that I am a student at IIT is, this point which is going to be on the book is for good knowledge encapsulation or good knowledge enhancement, which is secondary. The primary point is naturally the tag of IIT, number one. Number two, the placement. A very high level placement in the first page of the newspaper, if it can tell that IIT's, you know, 62 candidates of IIT Delhi are getting 1 crore job, that is the attraction which has got to be understood. And now, therefore, these students, who are coming under the virtual institution, who are not the direct student of any of these institutions, cannot participate in the campus placement activity of any institution. No institution shall take the responsibility of campus placement of these particular students unless these one or two of these candidates are extremely brilliant and that particular IIT or particular institution would be very keen on this candidate in absorbing him as a PhD candidate. Except that the other way around, the getting them campus placed by these institutions should not be the prerogative of these institutions. This has got to be understood very clearly. Government of India also should have got to understand this particular point clearly. And now the coordinating virtual institution's responsibility is to have the campus placement also. So campus placement should be coordinated by the virtual institution, because these candidates belong to the virtual institutions. However, they get transported through several other institutions. That has got to be understood. Now, who is going to award the degrees? So our degree has got to be awarded by the consortium, degree has got to be awarded by this remote institution, degree has got to be awarded by this virtual institution or an open institution, call it by whatever the name. And now, if we are concentrating on the flow, if we are focusing on the flow of these candidates through only INIs, even this virtual institution by default has got to be an institution of national importance only. Now this virtual institution at one end has got to cater to the mobility of the students only amongst IITs, because let us categorically understand that the students who are going to join IITs are with the joint not only the JEE, but also with the advanced examination. Therefore, the no IIT straight away would be preferring to take a candidate only with a JEE. So that has got to be understood. And similarly, in NITs and IITs, NITs and IIITs, the candidates who would join would be with joint entrance examination. Therefore, they will not be ready to accept the candidates who would have completed the common entrance test at the state level to enter into their institution, which has got to be understood. Therefore, one has got to think of three bubbles. The virtual institution should think of three bubbles. One bubble for mobility of the students through IITs. Another bubble has got to be for the students' mobility through IITs and NITs. And another bubble is for ISERs, ISRO institutions, and other INIs. And there can be an interface between, a rare interface between all these institutions, across all these institutions, for certain courses not exceeding some particular limit, particularly one semester or not more than two semesters in an 8-semester scheme. So this has got to be thought of. So the virtual institution shall provide all this interface, and it is called virtual because academy is virtual in this institution. Coordination and administration is real by this virtual institution, or call it a consortium. Awarding the degrees, as I mentioned, has got to be the job of this consortium, or has got to be the job of this coordinating institution. Enabling the learners with extra co-curricular activities, this has got to be done by this virtual institution. They cannot. These students, incidentally, during that semester, if there is any festival which is happening in that institution, can probably be participating, but they have got to have their own extracurricular activities. These extracurricular activities have got to be planned by the virtual institution only. So placement enabling, extracurricular enabling, everything has got to be done by the virtual institution. However, what is more important and what is very relevant, what is very necessary, is to provide the proper counseling for the transportation of these candidates, for the movement of these candidates across the institution. Counseling is the most important, and here all faculty members of all participating institutions should become the counselors. So this is the point where we should think of flexibility at a higher level. So participating institutions should be allowed to follow their own academic practices. Whatever they have been doing, whatever they have done, whatever have been their design, they would be just sharing that. So the participating institution shall not be compelled to design any specific course for these mobile students, any different course for the, whatever has been there, it has got to be shared. Therefore, the participating institution should be able to tell, in the odd semester I can share so much, and in the even semester I can share so much, and additionally I can take so many students, that's all, additionally. And then the participating institution should definitely be not compelled to design any new specific courses only for these candidates, and the participating institution should not be compelled to change their graded pattern, to change their credit pattern or grading pattern. And it is the virtual institution which has got to work out all this interface. So this is where the administration has got to be taken over by the consortium. And now student has to get joined to the consortium. Now look at this. Now when it comes to the bubble of IITs, which candidate will join this? The candidates who join this bubble would surely be those candidates who could not get into any of the physical IITs. Therefore, he is getting into virtual IIT balloon. Similarly, even IIITs or NITs, anyone who could not get into the physical NIT or who could not get into any physically existing IIIT, naturally his rank order would be far lower than any of the NIT will be getting into this bubble, hoping that he can traverse through these institutions. So flexibility at one end is very interesting point, but the flexibility not to spoil the spirit of academy has got to be very thoroughly be concerned. So this is how I would love to look at flexibility. One, flexibility at the institution level. Two, the flexibility at the institution level is possible if we overcome our intrinsic property of being very conservative, that one has got to be strongly electronics, one has got to be strongly computer science, one has got to be strongly mechanical engineering. So that conservative aspect has got to be overcome. Three, then flexibility at the inter-institutional level, which has got to be operationalized through the MOUs, through the understanding. And when we transport our candidate for the entire one semester, we should be aware that that institution should accommodate him for the entire semester. Four, this, the real flexible system where a virtual institution will coordinate, taking the advantage of academic infrastructure available, which all these institutions will agree to share. So thank you very much for sharing, for allowing me to present my views. And thank you very much for such a patient hearing. Thank you very much.